We have Durga Shankar Mishra sir, who is the Secretary for Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, and he talks about various initiatives taken by ministry in last 5 years and his vision for the next 5 years. How has been your experience?
Well, I have been in this ministry for over 5 years now. Initially, for the first 3 years, I was the Assistant Secretary. And then there were two ministries. One was the Ministry of Urban Development. I was on that urban development side. And there was another Ministry of Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation. But in 2017, two ministries were merged together and formed into a single ministry of Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. I am the first secretary of that merged ministry from 2017 June onwards. Well, my experience in the last 5 years have been immense. Because prior to this, I had also served some stint in my state government. One as a vice chairman of the Development Authority in Kanpur, municipal commissioner in Kanpur, and also principal secretary of Urban Development of Uttar Pradesh. But in the last 5 years, I have seen there has been so much of change. The complete approach has changed in the urban development, in the whole sphere of urbanization.
So Smart Cities Mission, how has been the progress of Smart Cities Mission? It has changed a view among the ULBs, various cities. How has been the progress right now?
See, a Smart City Mission is kind of a lighthouse mission where absolutely new kind of a thinking was brought in the urban development. For the first time, there was engagement with people at a large scale, so that let people think what they want their city to become, how the city will deliver them the best ease of living, what kind of changes are needed in the city so that it provides them the livelihood opportunities. And based on that, through a city challenge method, 100 cities were selected. You know, this has been done in 4 phases. And the last phase got concluded in June 2018 when we selected the 100th city of Shillong as the last smart city. The whole approach is different. Now here there is a special purpose vehicle. It's like a company which is running the smart city. There is a project management consultant, PMC, is a technical group which is helping the smart city into converting the aspirations of the people, the plan which has been approved, that plan converted into the projects, and that is getting implemented on ground. And again, there is engagement with the people, with the people's representative, etc. The total projects in the smart city were planned for nearly 205,000 crores. Out of that, so far, we have already been able to get into different stages of implementation, nearly 136,000 crores. More than 90,000 crores projects are already grounded and they are under construction. More than 15,000 crores projects are already completed. Now you can see in 16 cities, we have got a smart command and control centers already operational. I mean, one of the examples you can see during the Kumbh Mela, there was a smart command and control center in Prayagraj, and that has helped in a big way in crowd control. In some of the cities like the big events, how things are organized, even the crime is coming down, compliances of the traffic rules, improvement in the water utilization, even the user charges, improvement in sanitation, improvement in mobility, various things it is directly impacting the life of the people. We have nearly 25 kilometers of roads converted into smart road. When you say smart road means, I mean, all the utilities are underground. I mean, it looks very neat and clean. It is a walkable, it is cyclable. It's a good environment to be in that kind of a road. It's a road meant for the people. And work on nearly 100 kilometers is in progress in different cities. We have got a smart water, where it is not only the infrastructure, but also using the power of ICT, that is information and communication technology, and the sensors. I mean, now in a big way, we are able to use water in a very effective way. There is a large usage of the solar. I mean, almost like 10% of the power is coming through the solar. So, rooftop solar systems have been laid. There is a smart wastewater system, a smart sanitation system. Some of the facilities like heritage, like water bodies, lakefront, riverfront, I mean, they have been improved. People have a different kind of a life there. Education system, there is a electronic education system where there is a better delivery of the ideas, the concepts to the children using a smart education system. There is a better facility for in the parks and the public places. All these things, all these developments are there, and continuously, I mean, this is like a laboratory, and what we are doing in this place, we are leveraging that, the knowledge, the experience we are getting from there to the other cities. Now, the other cities have also started implementing various things which have come from the experiment of the smart cities.
So, we talk about smart cities, the cities are transforming right now. How has been the progress of Amrut? And we talk about tier 2 cities and tier 3 cities.
Well, unlike a smart city where it is a lighthouse, the Amrut is infrastructure, where the first focus was on providing water to every household in 500 cities whose population is 100,000 plus. Also improving the total sanitation, like wastewater treatment in terms of the sewer and STP or the septic treatment or fecal sludge and septic management concept, whatever is working, because for different places, different settings, different kind of things work. Also providing green spaces or the public spaces for the community in all the cities. Some money also goes to the improving the non-motorized transport, like public mobility. This project we had already sanctioned 2 years back, nearly 77,600 crore. I mean, there were three plans for these 500 cities that had already been sanctioned. So far, the progress is we have completed the work which has already been completed is around 4,500 crores. But the work which is already under construction, it is to the tune of more than 61,000 crores. And at different stages, something like 74,000-75,000 crore work is at different stages. Under this, we were supposed to provide 1.39 crore water taps. So far, we have already provided 67 lakhs water taps. There are various other things like say sewer connections. I mean, we have already provided nearly 37 lakhs sewer connections. LED lights on the streets, nearly 67 lakhs LED lights have been transformed into, I mean, changed from the normal lights into the LED lights. To make the cities dependent on themselves, we did the credit rating of the cities. 485 cities we did the credit rating. And 36 of them came into credit worthy, that is, the ratings were more than A minus plus. So far, 9 cities have already raised municipal bond to the tune of nearly 3400 crores. I mean, you might have seen in the recent news, many other cities are in the process to have to get their own municipal bond issued. So that way there is a more focus on self-dependence. Now, online building permission system, which to make people's life simpler, I mean, if you want to get a building approved, it used to take sometimes months, sometimes even years. In Delhi and Mumbai, we have improved it in a big way. I mean, this has been recognized by the World Bank in their ease of doing business report. Our rank was 181 last year, previous year. Last year, our rank jumped to 52, almost by 129 places. This is a phenomenal. And this thing was not only restricted to Delhi and Mumbai. So far, in 1,705 cities, and out of that, 439 are the Amrut cities, whose population is more than 100,000. They also have implemented this online building permission system. Apart from this, there is a major focus on the capacity building, not only to our employees who are the municipal employees, but also to the other executive like political executives. So they are also sensitized so that they get, I mean, the focus is on to providing facilities to the public and improving the ease of living.
So we talk about Amrut, we talk about smart cities. Our Prime Minister launched Housing for All, a scheme which was beneficial for a common man. How has been that doing?
Well, Housing for All, when the Honorable Prime Minister launched on 25th June of 2015, his mandate was that by 2022, when we celebrate 75th anniversary of Indian independence, everybody must have their own house. On that mandate, we went to the states and union territories and validated the demand. I mean, all those people who either did not have their house of their own or they had inadequate housing, or the housing was in a bad shape. Because when the Prime Minister says housing does not mean only four walls. Housing means a house which has got a toilet, which has got a drinking water, which has got kitchen, has a gas facility, has an electricity facility. So it's a complete house, so that it provides a good quality of life to the person who is living there, and he is able to realize his dreams. The total demand came out to nearly 1 crore, slightly more than a crore. So far, we have been able to sanction more than, almost like 84 lakhs houses so far. And out of that, nearly 50 lakhs houses have been grounded for construction. It's 49.67 lakhs houses, that is the latest figure I have. And more than 26 lakhs houses are complete and they are now inhabited by your beneficiaries. You can go to any city and you will find. I feel so happy. Recently I went to Nagaland. In Kohima, I had to really walk many stairs to go to the place where they have constructed their houses. So, and when I asked them the kind of happiness, the kind of delight they have, because this was their life's dream and that has been fulfilled through the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. And this is one aspect. The another aspect is there is a big change. A lot of policy measures have been taken, like one I mentioned about the online building permission system. There is a fiscal and the financial various measures, like in the income taxes, in the GST, various changes has been done. Also on the technology front, because technology front, we already have some new technologies available with us. 16 of them, for that schedule of rates have been issued by our CPWD, and nearly 13 lakhs houses out of the 50 lakhs houses I mentioned, they are being constructed using the new technology. But on the direction of Honorable Prime Minister, last year, we started a process of global housing technology challenge, because we want to now, with this kind of a construction of more than a crore houses, we want to get the best technologies available across the world. And there was a very good response from different players across the globe. Some 54 new technologies participated in our Construction Technology India Conference, which was held in the month of March this year. And we have selected 6 places as lighthouse projects, which will work like laboratories for these new technologies. The RFP is already on, and we are waiting by early August, we'll be able to finalize. And by September, we'll be able to ground these 6 lighthouses projects. All 6 will have different kind of technologies, and these technologies are basically resource efficient. So the minimum resources are used. They are environmental friendly, so the minimum damage to the environment. They take much lesser time, because the usual construction technology takes around, 2 years, 2.5 years, that kind of a time frame. And here you can reduce the time to less than a year. 6 months, 9 months, you can construct, say, multi-storied building. So it reduces the time, reduces the cost, improves the livability. So this is another initiative which the ministry has taken. And now we are also working on, because it's a large scale construction of the unit, single houses is being done across the country. Nearly 55% of the 84 lakhs are beneficiary-led construction. So there, a lot of people have come through, very innovative people are there. They have come through different kind of technology to reduce the cost, to make things happen fast. So we are going to hold a kind of a exhibition of such technologies which have been developed locally and which can help this kind of a single construction, help our beneficiaries to do things much faster with a much lesser cost and a longevity, more longevity. So there are a lot of things happening on the housing front. One new initiative which has been taken very recently, we have uploaded it now, because in the urban area, unlike in the rural area, urban area, there is a lot of migration. There is a migration from the rural to the urban area. There is a migration within the urban areas, like from Delhi, from east to west, west to north, people keep moving, or from one city to another city. So one cannot think of constructing houses in every city wherever he is going, for the sake of education, for his business, for work or anything for that matter. So what is most important in the urban area is the rental housing. And we have the rental laws of the state, which is basically the state subject. Rental laws of the states are dating 60s, 70s, 80s, and where there was so much focus on protecting the rights of the rentee and not of the renter. So nobody comes forward. One of the data which I can share with you, our 2011 census says 1.1 crore houses are lying vacant. Another data I can share with you, Forbes says that Indian market has got $20 billion US dollar market of the rental housing. which translate to nearly 1.5 lakhs crore. Our NSSO of 98-99, the NSSO 98-99, they say that nearly 84% of the rental housing is informal. There is no written agreement. It all depends on your word. So, to bring that into a informal to the formal structure and provide a level playing field so that both renter and the rentee, they are happy through an agreement, they honor their agreement, and there is a body, government body, which helps them to ensure that whatever they commit, they comply with it. So, we have prepared a Model Rental Act, is a Model Tenancy Act, and this Model Tenancy Act have been uploaded on our website for seeking the public and the stakeholders' comments. I mean, there will be a lot of stakeholders, there may be, I mean, the agents will be there, those who may be interested. I mean, this will open up a new kind of a market where people can construct rental housing and give it for rent. I mean, maybe for the students, maybe for the working women, maybe for the, some kind of a different places who are different kind of people who are migrating to a place for some purpose. So, this kind of a thing, I mean, co-living or a spaces shared by the different people, the different kinds of the renting that can become very popular in the market. So, this is there, we are seeking their comments, and I am sure in next couple of months we will be able to finalize this Model Rental Housing Act, and this will be shared with the state government so that they come out, replace their old act with this new act.
So, I feel this Rent Act will be a game changer for the people who are migrating to different cities.
Definitely. This will make their life very simple, and this is going to open up a new market.
So, we talk about housing for all. Now, we are about to be finished with 5 years of Swachh Bharat Mission on 2nd of October. What has been the achievement of this Swachh Bharat Mission? How has it changed the ground level?
There has been tremendous progress. I mean, the Swachh Bharat Mission, you can see for yourself how the behavior has changed in the cities. I mean, earlier when I was going from here to my residence, I used to see that people just open their screen of the car and throw something here and there. Now that kind of a scene is no more there. You don't see that when people go to the park, people don't throw things here and there. People have become conscious. I won't say it's 100% change, but there's a tremendous change in the behavior of the people as far as the waste littering is concerned. Now, if you take, there are three kinds of things which were targeted under the Swachh Bharat Mission. When the Prime Minister made this announcement on 15th August 2014 from the rampart of the Red Fort, at that time everybody is very skeptic, how this is possible. But now everybody has a faith. In fact, this is one program of my ministry which has touched everybody. Here, the first target is open defecation free. And open defecation free out of some 4,378 cities, 4,265 cities are already declared open defecation free. 24 states are fully open defecation free, and many more are coming in next couple of months. Much before 2nd of October, it is going to be 100% open defecation free. And we are not happy there. We want to go make it ODF plus and ODF plus plus. When I say ODF plus means, not only you create toilets, like we have constructed more than 5 lakhs public toilets and community toilets. We have constructed nearly 65 lakhs individual toilets. We not only construct toilets, but also make sure that they are under use. And they are under use only if they are hygienic, they are clean, so, and there is a facility for water, then only they will be used. So, this is being ensured through the ODF plus, and we have 377 cities which are ODF plus. We have gone beyond, we have made it ODF plus plus, which is another level of that fecal sludge which is being generating. That fecal sludge is securely through scientifically this is managed, and that facility there, 77 cities are now ODF plus plus. We have also developed an app, Google app. More than 1700 cities, almost like 47,000 plus toilets, they are on the Google map. I mean, you go to Delhi and just put it on Google map, you know that where is the your closest toilet. So, you can reach out there rather than defecating here and there in the public. And then comes the solid waste management. So, whole solid waste management, which was barely around 15% in 2014, has rose to now 56%. We are collecting door to door in nearly 94% of the wards. Segregation, wet and dry waste is being done in nearly 64% of the wards. And this processing is nearly 56%. So this is a huge progress, and we are following it up with the cities. This progress we want to make it 100%. Now, behavioral change, I find that there has been a phenomenal participation by different segment of the society. We started with Honorable Prime Minister, started with Satyagrahi, like we had a Satyagrahi for the National Independence Movement. So, we had Satyagrahi for the our cleanness movement, and there we started with every city have got Satyagrahi, National Level of Satyagrahi, but now I find that everybody is Satyagrahi. This kind of a change people had not expected, but it is happening in a big way, whether it is the housewives or it is the old or young or the children, schools, everywhere people are becoming conscious of cleanliness. There is another advantage which has come out which you had not seen earlier. There is a new entrepreneurship in cleanness. There is a lot of value has come out of it. People have developed new kind of businesses using waste. In fact, some of the states, large number of employment had come through the waste. In a state of Chhattisgarh, nearly 9,000 ladies which are our self-help workers, self-help group, they are employed, getting almost like 9,000 to 12,000 rupees a month through waste segregation. And it is not only Chhattisgarh, in many states, the kabadiwalas, they used to be kabadiwala in the informal sector. Now, their job has been formalized. So, they are able to segregate things, and through that, they are able to get much more value than what they were getting. So, this has opened up a completely new kind of a job profile, new kind of employment, new kind of entrepreneurship, new startups in the Swachhta. And I think the way things are happening, I think in very soon, the Prime Minister's vision of New India, when everything is neat and clean, have a lot of changes that is going to be realized soon.
So, we will be continuing this Swachh Bharat mission after 2nd of October, sir?
Well, there is two things. One is the mission, other is this. Cleanness is not one day job or two day job or a 1 month or a 1 year job. It is going to be, as a human being, we are going to continuously, we will defecate, we are going to create garbage, we are going to do that. Yes, we can definitely learn how to reduce the total garbage creation so that we can reuse things, we can recycle things. So, that way the total garbage creation will be reduced, but the garbage is going to be there. So, this phenomenon will continue happening. In what form people have learnt, they are going to improve that.
So, you have travelled to almost all the smart cities. I will be asking you this question, which are the favourite cities for you?
Well, let me tell you, smart cities, I have been to many of them, and then they are at different stages. Like, our country is like a garden, and in that garden, every flower is not of the same colour, same shape, same kind of fragrance. There are all differences there. Similarly, in our country, or even in one state, if you take one state, you will find different cities at different levels. So, one difference between one city and another city is because they were selected in different rounds. Definitely, the city selected in the first round will be far ahead than the second, third and fourth. Two, some of them are pioneers. They wanted to take things much faster. But I find, the cities in Gujarat, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Andhra Pradesh, they have taken over much faster. They have gone much faster, and other states, they are all catching up. The new thing which what it did with was, like, initially we were quite dependent from outside. When the smart city was started, when the Honorable Prime Minister wanted us to do this smart city, we didn't even know what the smart city is and how it is to be done. This ministry itself was struggling for quite some time to come to a complete understanding of what is that we need to do. Then we came with the guidelines, with the approval of the Union Cabinet, and then we started implementing. And we are so much dependent on the outside. There was so much of, we have support from different countries, different missions, different organizations. But now we have developed so much of expertise that one smart city is helping another smart city. It is not only within the state, but also across the state. The smart cities in Maharashtra helping smart city in, say, some other state, smart city in Madhya Pradesh helping some other smart city in other place. And then there is so much of co-learning. We have CEOs conference. So we had the first CEO's conference of the smart city in Bhopal. We had the next CEO's conference in Delhi. And now I'm planning to have the third CEO's conference very soon, in another couple of months, where all these learnings are going to be shared with each other.
So the next conference will be there. So how do you think this technology, bringing all these missions of Ministry of Housing and Affairs, have decreased the gap between the ULBs, the ministry, the private sector? How has that done?
The way my ministry has worked in the last 5 years, we have tried to bring the complete focus on citizens. It is immaterial what we are doing, whether it is to the housing, whether it is to the Swachh Bharat or National Urban Livelihood Mission or Amrut, we focus on the citizens. And keeping citizens in focus, things have been planned. And there it is not only the job of the central government, but the central government, the state government, the local government, and the whole lot of people around it. It constitutes the experts, it constitutes the academic institution, it constitutes the foreign missions, all of them working together in some form or other. So there have been a lot of consultations. And it has created an environment. In fact, capacity was one big challenge for us. And this capacity, now we are kind of trying to develop a network of capacities and using our information technology platform in a big way. Because what Goa is doing in something, and they have developed a niche in that, can that become a experience for Lucknow? Or what Hyderabad has, then can it become experience for say Chandigarh? So IT has made things very possible. And here in my own ministry, we have got a National Urban Observatory. This is housed on the fifth floor, you can go and see that. And from there, all our data, we are sharing the data with the different cities, we can directly interact with them. We can collate data of different kinds, not only of my ministry, but other ministry. So we are giving so much of focus on the data. And that is also going to help us in building our capacities.
Anything else you want to share with us?
Well, I would like to say that Honorable Prime Minister has envisioned our country to progress from nearly $3 trillion economy, we are nearly $2.85 trillion economy right now, to $5 trillion economy by 2022, when we celebrate the 75th anniversary. And to $10 trillion economy by 2030, when the SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals, are complete, that the period is complete. So this kind of nearly three times of jump over a period of, say, next 10 years, a decade, this is a huge challenge. And this challenge is possible when you use urbanization as a major opportunity. See, the Honorable Finance Minister in a budget speech said that urbanization is a big challenge, but we take this as an opportunity. Our population in the urban area is currently, say, around 34% or so. It is projected to grow to nearly 40%, nearly 60 crore by 2030, and 80 crore plus by 2050. This will require huge amount of infrastructure to build. One approach is to let it happen the way it is happening. Then we create chaos. Then we create dissatisfaction, then we are going to create disorder. But other approach is to use this opportunity. This the huge migration happening to the urban place. When we do this, for example, in our metro system, we started just in early 2000, for the first time, Honorable the then Prime Minister C. Atal Bihari Vajpayee in 2002, he inaugurated nearly 8.5 kilometer metro system in Delhi. And today we are 657 kilometers. We have nearly 900 kilometers of metros under different stages of construction. It also includes regional rapid transport from Meerut to Delhi. We have more than 900 kilometers of metros under planning, metros and RRTS under planning in different places. So we can use this opportunity, and this is a lot of make in India. And for the first time, our company BML, they got an order of 378 metro coaches of Mumbai, worth more than 3,400 crores. Lot of things of the metro, they are being built here within India. So even the smart city, as I mentioned, lot of things where we were dependent from outside, now we have started doing things within. So there is so much of opportunity, and all these opportunities, I mean, we utilize this. Ultimately, we are going to provide ease of living to our people. In fact, ease of living index, for the first time we did last year. We are working on the second version of the ease of living index for this year, and that is going to be our regular phenomenon. Swachh Sarvekshan we did, and how our cities are ranked in the cleanliness index. This is something which is a phenomenal, I mean, this kind of a thing is not done in any part of the world. All these are creating opportunities, and this is going to drive our economy from the $3 trillion to the $5 trillion to the $10 trillion economy. So I find urbanization is a big, is a huge opportunity. We have to see how we help in planning our ways, how we can see that decongestion is there. Our population has got a good quality of air. I mean, that will require the planning of the urban transport as well as the urban habitation to go together hands in hand. And since lot of things too, I mean, we are only at a stage where we are taking off. So much more than this is going to come in the next few years. So that will, I mean, the way we do it, and I think our Honorable Prime Minister has given us a path, given us a direction in the last 5 years, and this 5 year is going to be another, we are going to ride much faster than what we did in the last 5 years. So this will lead to that big change.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.